I need someone to help me clean my house. J'ai besoin d'aide pour mon jardin.
Qui peut promener mon chien?
I need someone to help me babysit.
Can someone help me organize
my car? J'ai besoin d'aide pour
mon jardin.
I want to learn to play piano.
Hi, good morning. I hope that you guys are doing well and thank you for tuning in again in our online service this Sunday morning. And before we start, I hope that you guys are ready to worship God and sing songs of praises to Him. And also our hearts are ready to receive God's word this morning through His servant. But before we go through those things, let's take our Bible and open it in Lamentations chapter 3. Lamentations chapter 3, verse 22 to 25. The first part of 25. If you're there, say amen to your neighbor. Alright. Or just type in amen if you don't have a neighbor. Alright, it says in verse 22, because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for His compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will wait for Him. The Lord is good to those whose hope is in Him. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness. Lord, whatever we have gone through, Lord God, this whole week, Father, may you be glorified, be magnified, oh God. Lord, I pray, Lord Jesus, whatever that we have done that is not right before you this morning or the whole week, Father, I pray, Lord God, that we would apologize, say sorry, Lord God, Jesus, repent, Lord God, from our wickedness, Lord. Father, thank you for your love, thank you for your compassion, O Lord God, for it is new every morning, O Lord. It is new this morning, O Lord God, as we come together, O Lord God, in this manner. I pray, O Lord, that your spirit be upon every home, O Lord God, every family, O Lord God, Jesus. Lord, today we want to glorify you, O Lord, with the songs that we will sing. We want to glorify you, O Lord God, Jesus, with the word, O Lord God, that we will receive. We want to glorify you, O Lord God, Jesus, as you speak, O Lord God, that we may open our hearts, O Lord God, and be changed, O Lord, by your word. God, we thank you, Lord God, Jesus, for the things that we have received, O Lord God, we have gone through this week. And Lord, thank you. Thank you for the provision. Thank you for the roof, O Lord God, Jesus, that you have provided for us, Lord. Lord, we glorify you. We magnify you, Lord, this Sunday. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I hope that you guys are ready. Let's hear from the worship team. Hey, it's me again. Come on, join me in worshiping God with these songs of praises to Him, because He is worthy. Amen.
I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love. In the dead of night, you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're good, good, you're a good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, It's who I am. It's who I am.
I've seen.
I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, because you know just what we need before we say a word. And you're good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us, someone sing, he's perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To love so undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love. Love, love. I say you're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. Come on, sing. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us, you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. Perfect, he's perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us, you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us,
yes, Lord. Thank you, God, for your goodness, your faithfulness, O Lord. Never changing, O Lord. Oh, we praise you, Lord God, for who you are, Lord. For what you have done, Lord God, to us. Lord, who are we, O God, Jesus? To give you praise, O Lord, to give you glory. May these songs, O Lord God, be a pleasing aroma, Lord, before you, Lord, this morning. All we want to glorify is you. All we want to lift up today is you, Lord. We set aside, Lord, the things that distract us, O Lord God, from focusing on you, God. We worship you, Lord.
Sing for Jesus, I love you. Jesus, I love you. I'm singing.
Defeated for
lifted high forever. He is risen, He is alive, He is alive. The ground began to shake, the stones rolled away, His perfect love could not be overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated forever. He is glorified forever. He is lifted high forever. He is risen. He is alive. He is alive. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome, yes, Jesus. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome once again. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb. The Lamb has overcome forever. He is glorified forever. He is lifted high forever. He is risen. He is alive. He is alive. He is alive. He is alive. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. The Lamb has overcome. The King has overcome death. That is why we sing hallelujah to the King of Kings. Hallelujah to the one who is coming. Sing forever, forever glorified, forever magnified, forever lifted high, King of all kings, forever glorified, forever you are lifted high. King Jesus, We bow down to you, Lord.
Lord, glorify you, Lord Jesus. In everything we do, Lord, prepare our hearts. In everything we do, Lord God Jesus, may be glorified, be magnified, Lord. May we be the one to be seen, Lord. Not what we can do, O Lord God, or what good things we say, O Lord. But because, Lord, by your Spirit, we are able to do things, O Lord God, for your kingdom. Lord, as we hear your word through your servant, I pray that you may be the one to speak in our hearts. Change our hearts, O Lord. May we focus, O Lord God, on what you're going to say today through your servant. Lord, we thank you. We give you back all glory and all adoration from your creation, Lord. This we pray in Jesus' name.
All right, Lighthouse, I hope that you guys are ready and focused as we receive God's word through his servant today. His servant that we have as a speaker is a young man of God. He just became a dad actually last September, and he just had a baby daughter named Esther Moira. And he is also the vice president of LL Ministries here in Belgium. And he is a student in CTS. He is in his third year. And also, he is the only English guy in the Lighthouse Center. And let's welcome Matthew Sims.
Good morning, everyone. Kamusta. I hope I've said it right. Kamusta to everyone. Kamusta to the church. That means hello in, I think it's Tagalog. I hope that you're all keeping well, and that you are all staying close to God and loving him more and more each day, even in these difficult times we've been living in. We are keeping well, and we look forward to seeing you again in person, but thankfully we can, with this modern technology, we can stay in touch this way and share to you the word of God. Anyway, I'm not good at the small talk at the beginning, so I'll just get into it. I'll start with prayer, so please, would you bow your heads in prayer? Please, Jimwell, also do that and get off your phone. Thank you, Father, for this day. Thank you because you are a good God. Thank you because you are our Savior. Thank you that you are in control of everything. And Lord, we just place everything into your hands today. We surrender everything to you, Father. I pray that as I share your word, even on this video and that gets shown on the Sunday, that you would speak to the church, Lord, and especially in the subject, that you would illuminate us, that you would reveal your truth to us, and that you would reveal your heart to us, and that you would touch our lives and make us more like Jesus, because that's the whole point of this. We want to be more like you, Jesus. We want to know you better. Lord, we don't want to just hear something or do something on a Sunday morning to pass the time, but we want to grow in love with you through your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, I'm going to be carrying on today from where Vivian left us off lastly, when she shared a few weeks ago, or a month ago, whatever it was. I've got some scriptures to go to, but I would like to start just with Isaiah 61 verses 1-3, which is what she was focusing on last time. I'll give a little recap of what she said, and then I'll carry on to what I want to share today, and then I think that we'll need, if we get invited back to speak one or maybe two times, to carry on what's really on our heart. What we're sharing today is really what we believe God has called me and Vivian to, the healing and deliverance ministry. It's what we do outside church with a ministry called LL, which I've shared about in church. And look, it's a very hot topic, and it's something that people don't always agree with. And I'm a bit worried I'm not going to explain it to the best of my ability. So please, after you hear this, if it sounds a bit confusing or it doesn't make sense, don't just throw it out or put it in the bin, but pray over it, do some research online, and go ultimately to the Bible, because everything has to come from here. So I'm going to be clicking on things because I got my information here, the scriptures, so please, I hope that doesn't distract you. So Isaiah 61:1-3. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the afflicted. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and freedom to prisoners, to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord, and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to grant those who mourn in Zion, giving them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a spirit of fainting. So they will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. So this is, like I said, a bit of recap. Isaiah is the most quoted prophet in the New Testament. And this book, written by Isaiah, deals with the time when judgment of the enemies and deals with the time when the judgment of the enemies, the salvation for Israelites, and the opposition of the unfaithful collides. The prophet preaches confidence and faith to the people who are facing a spiritual darkness season. And in addition to this, he declares the year of freedom. However, thinking about our lives and the time we live in now, we live in a period of time between the first coming of Christ and the second coming of Christ. And it is still a time when we know humanity longs for healing and deliverance. That doesn't need to be explained, just watch the news. It is a time where people are carrying the burden of their sins and not knowing how to get free. Anyone in the church have that burden? I do, sometimes. Anyone in the church feel like they don't know how to get free from burdens and afflictions in their life? We have to be vulnerable and admit these things. They had the beginning of what God had promised, but not the fullness of it. This fullness comes through Jesus. So, this word in Isaiah 61 was partially fulfilled in this time, but they were still waiting for its ultimate fulfillment, which came through Jesus, which we know he came much later. Israel, always throughout their history, they lived and longed for a redeemer. Not only a redeemer from their physical slavery, but a redeemer from their souls. And the focus and point of the healing and deliverance ministry is, we may not be physically slaves here in Belgium, wherever you're watching from. You may have a good job, you have a car, you can do whatever you want with your life. You are not in a prison, you're not being persecuted for the faith. But inside you, you are a prisoner. Inside you, you have burdens. And inside you, you are in chains. And you may be a believer that loves God, baptized in the Spirit, praying in tongues, just passionate for God. Yet there's something still that's keeping you in chains. And this is what we're going to come to a bit today. So, as we know, Israel went into the exile when this happened in 586 to 587 BC, when Babylon destroyed Jerusalem and brought the people captive. So here, why did Israel go into captivity? Because of disobedience. And as I'll be explaining later, one big thing that brings our soul or our spirit inside of us into prison is sin, which is the same as what they were doing. You see, in the Old Covenant, everything was dealt with on the exterior level. The sacrifices, the shedding of blood, everything. This is why God brought all these feasts and all the sacrifices into place in the Old Testament, because everything had to be dealt with externally. But as New Covenant, born-again Christians today, after Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, we do things internally. That's why the Bible says we don't have circumcision of the flesh. Ow! We have circumcision of the heart. And that is the important thing we have to understand. Everything we are trying to deal with is now inside us. Now we don't have a physical temple. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit as the church, but also individual parts of that temple. I hope I'm explaining it, because sometimes I don't understand myself. So Israel, and this was fulfilled in later on after the captivity. There was a time when God raised up King Cyrus. Everyone knows King Cyrus. Well, most of you may know him, who was from Persia, and he came and destroyed the Babylonians in 538 to 539 BC. So the Jews, Israelites, were in captivity by the Babylonians, and they were in captivity for a long time. But then another empire came, destroyed the Babylonians, and this king, Cyrus, allowed the Jews to return to the land. So in many ways, they were brought out of captivity, out of exile, back to the land. So this scripture was partially fulfilled, but the people still remained in spiritual darkness. You know the history, you carry on reading your Bible. You know, the Old Testament ends on a very bad note. I can't exactly remember, but turn there when you have time. Actually, maybe I'll do that to help you, in case you don't want to turn there. And it's good for me to be reminded. Okay, the last verse, the last two verses in the Old Testament, Malachi 4, 5 to 6. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes, and he will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, the hearts of the children to their fathers, lest they come and strike the land with a decree of utter destruction. Wow, doesn't sound so hopeful. So what I'm trying to say is this is long time after. The Israelites are still in spiritual darkness. They are not serving God as they should do. Even though Israel wasn't in physical slavery anymore because they'd returned to the land, they were slaves in their souls because of the consequence of their sins. King Cyrus could free them physically, but not spiritually. So, what does that mean? The ultimate fulfillment of this scripture could only be done through the Messiah. A prophet could not do this himself. Only a Messiah, only the Messiah to come could do this. So that's kind of a recap of what Vivian had said and where she left us. And I just want to go now to Luke 4, 16 to 30. And this is now in the New Testament. So Jesus comes. As you know the story, he's baptized, he gets tempted in the wilderness. He really suffers in the wilderness, and he comes back in the power of the Holy Spirit. And then his first preaching, let's say, assignment or first invite to preach was at a synagogue in Nazareth. And it says this in Luke 4, 6, I'll just read Luke 4, 16 to 20. And Jesus came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as was his custom, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and he stood up to read. And the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set to liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the liberty of the Lord's favor. And he rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And all the eyes of the synagogue were fixed on him, and he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." Wow. So imagine you're there at that time. You, as a good Jew, know all the Bible pretty well. Some of them could memorize maybe a lot, maybe most of it. And you hear this rabbi coming in and saying, "This has been fulfilled in front of you." He's basically saying that I am this. I am what you've been waiting for. The Spirit of the Lord is upon him. We know that Jesus was full of the Holy Spirit. He was anointed. He was set apart. He was chosen by God to proclaim the good news to the poor. He is the one that brings the good news to people. He has been sent to proclaim liberty to the captives. Now, and recovering of sight to the blind. Sight of the blind, that's a physical healing. Sent to proclaim liberty to the captives. It doesn't mean those who are physically in prison. It means those who are in captivity of sin. Set liberty those who are oppressed, people that have been oppressed by other people, or things that have been done to them by other people, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. So this is really why Jesus came, and this is what we want to go on to you now and explain to you, that I believe that a lot of churches and a lot of Christians and Pentecostals, we focus on when we in ministry, we focus on the teaching of the word, we focus on the preaching of the word. We're always praying for the sick. We believe that God heals, and we believe in evangelism, and we believe in mission. But one bit that I find in my experience, I've not been in church a long time, is very, 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 very little spoken of the internal side of us, of inner healing, of the inner brokenness of each of us. And you see, when we get born again, when we become Christians, we are brought from one kingdom, kingdom of darkness, to the kingdom of light. And that's a miracle in itself. But this then, when we're here, it means that there's still stuff that we've brought in from the kingdom of darkness into the light. And how to explain it is, imagine that you have a house. Your life is a house. Imagine you buy a nice house in Ukla. Big house. And it has 10 bedrooms. Imagine, like Pastor Clementi, he wins the lottery and he buys a big house for 1 million euros. And this house has 10 bedrooms. But when he buys it, he has to renovate it. But he still wants to buy the house. He loves the house. It's a beautiful location. He pays 1 million for it. After he renovates it, he can sell it for 10 million, okay? And that's a bit like our lives. God buys us. He bought us with the blood of Jesus as we repent and put faith in him. And he takes our lives. But from the moment we're born again, he starts this process. We call it sanctification. We call it becoming more like Christ. And one aspect of this journey is the inner healing and deliverance ministry. Because there are these rooms in our house that Clementi, for example, in this house, he has to change the wallpaper. It's falling off. There is rotting wood. Okay, imagine the walls are rotting. You can't leave that. The roof is leaking. You need to fix that. And it's like that in our life. We have been born again for many years. But in our house, we have our living room. And I've got this part of me. Oh, that's quite nice. But this part, you don't go there, God. It's painful. It's sore. It hurts. And it's like an area that's not fully in the light. And look, to be very honest, when I came back to God, I struggled so much because I had lived a bad life before, a sinful life before. And we must always remember that sin has consequences. I think today in the church, people don't like to say the word sin, repentance. Okay, people don't like to admit that you have to confess sin or say sorry when you mess up. But you do. You do. And it's all in the Bible. So when I came back to God, I really humbly came before God in repentance, said, God, I'm leaving that life, and I'm turning back to you, and I'm following you. But I brought a lot of junk with me, because when we get born again, it doesn't all go. And this is the key thing that I wanted to talk about today in this short message, is that one of the main points of Jesus' ministry was the deliverance ministry. I'm not going to go through all the stories, but I think one third of them are about deliverance, about casting out demons. And people say, yeah, but we're a Christian, we can't have a demon. Look, the Bible says in Ephesians 4:27 that you're not to give the devil a foothold. This is talking to Christians. And the more that you, if you are purposefully walking in a sinful life, if you are purposeful, it means you're constantly doing it. I'm not picking on anyone. I'm not picking on any sin. But one that I think is very often happening in the church is sexual behavior outside marriage, which is a sin. If you are continually doing that without saying sorry to God, without turning and stopping, you are opening yourself up to the demonic. You are basically saying to the devil, come in. And it may be that God still owns you, but the devil has access. And a problem is that people can't accept the deliverance ministry because they say that we cannot be possessed by a devil. And I would agree. When we're born again, we are possessed by God. But when we are born again and we continually willfully sin and don't deal with things in our life, we can be held by a demon, or the Greek is, that's why I'm looking here, because the Greek is daimonizomai, daimonizomai, to have a demon or to be demonized. For sure we can have that. I've experienced deliverance in my own life, and I've seen people free from this. But it is a hugely contested subject in the body of Christ. There are denominations that say, no, a Christian cannot. And there are denominations that say, yes, a Christian can. I believe that they can. And I believe that this was the large part of Jesus' ministry. People say, yeah, but Jesus was still dealing with the Old Covenant people. Okay, but why would he tell the disciples to go out and to cast out demons? And then why does he, in the Great Commission in Matthew 28:18-20, command us to do everything that he's done and taught? Because we are happy to accept that teaching for evangelism, for preaching, for teaching, but we can't accept it for the inner healing or deliverance. And I just want you to be honest with yourselves. Be honest with your walk with God. Be honest with burdens that you're carrying in your life. Are there things inside of you that are, it's not right? Whether it be in your emotions, whether it be in your thinking. My big struggle when I came back to God was almost like, it was mental torment. And I'm not saying every difficulty or every struggle we go through is necessarily to do with the spiritual side, because some people get obsessed with it. We are still in a fallen world. There are areas of sickness and areas of internal stuff that just come because we live in this fallen world. Just, it is fallen. But there are also things that can be afflicting us because of the demonic. And the demonic comes like this first. Lying. What does it say about the devil? He's the father of lies. He comes here, he goes like this to you. He messes your emotion. He makes you walk in unforgiveness. He makes you walk in resentment. He makes you walk in bitterness. He tempts you. You sleep with this woman or man again and again and again. He tempts you. He says you've got a broken identity. He says that you're a no one will love you or this. And the more that you believe, receive, and act in this, you are potentially opening the door to the devil for a demonic influence in your life. And I know for some people it can be a scary thought, and for some people it can be worrying, but I'm not trying to do that. The truth is, I'm trying to help. This is what we have seen in this ministry, that people who have been honest and that God has shown them have really been gotten freedom in their life, and that's why I'm passionate about it. I'm not going to say, for other times if people want, and Vivian or myself can explain main areas that these things can come in, but yeah, well, the main areas would be your own sin. So if you're willfully going in sin, what people have done to you, when people do things to us that can leave a huge damage. And I'm not just talking about demons here. I'm talking about internal, your heart can be broken. What does it say here? It says that he sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives, to recovering of sight to bind at liberty those who are oppressed. So people who have been actually completely and utterly broken. Life breaks people, even Christians. Who here knows a Christian who's broken? Who here knows a Christian that can't get free from a sin? Or who's got an addiction? Or who is depressed? Or is broken on the inside from something that happened years ago? We all know it, but we don't talk about it in church. And this is what I'm passionate about. And in Isaiah 61:1, let me see. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted. Brokenhearted is a heart. Your heart is who you are, which is broken. It's been smashed by what's happened to you. Maybe your own things. Even when you were a child, a lot of huge traumas come to people in their early life. Because now I'm a father. I have a young daughter. I have to do everything now to tend to her and to help her develop into a young lady. And this is her forming years. These are her forming years. I think it's 1 to 6. So if she's not getting the love she needs, if she's not getting the nurture she needs, if she's not getting the protection from me, from her father and her mother, she's already got a stumbling block for her life. And a lot of that has happened to some of you. You had bad parents. Let's be honest. You love them, but they didn't give you what you needed in life. They didn't help you. They didn't support you. They even abusive parents, violent parents. You've been hurt in relationships before. All these things. And sometimes with this, there is given an access to the demonic. Sometimes, and together normally, is the inner healing, like the pain of the heart, and the devil comes on it and he goes like that. And it makes it tighter. And then the same thing happens again and again. You always feel rejected. You always feel you're going to be rejected. You always feel that you're going to that no one will love you. There's many things, but look, trust me here. These problems are the same for the whole church, worldwide. And it's God's grace and mercy. Do you not think that God is so good that he sent Jesus to die for us, but also to physically heal us? But not only that, Jesus can heal you on the inside. It's something that I don't understand why it's not taught in the churches. Because we all carry something. You see it every Sunday. Look at some of us. We look miserable. And then we go around with the right words. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. God is good. These are true. But on the inside, it's like, oh, it's sore. It hurts. I feel depressed. And that was me as well. And I'm still in this process. Look, so this is also a sanctification journey, what I'm explaining. That there's ongoing parts, like an onion. You pull off one layer and God's dealing with it. But there are times when we can really get free from things. And it's too late now, but I really feel I haven't explained it well. And I'm sorry, but it's something I'm really passionate about. So we have to just look at the ministry and the life of Jesus and say that it's the same for today. It never stopped. It never stopped. The woman caught in adultery. Adultery. Sorry, the woman caught in adultery. I'm losing my English. Sorry, because I'm learning Greek so much. No. The woman caught in adultery, she was brokenhearted. Jesus, in that tender and gentle loving, restored her. The woman who was bent over had an issue. A spirit was cast out of them and they were healed. You just have to read the gospel stories and see what Jesus was doing. Because you have to realize that our wrestle, the whole battle on earth, is not against flesh and blood. If you could only see the spiritual realm, there is God, there's the devil. They're not the same level, because that's not a good idea, but there's two sides. God is completely different, more powerful, but the devil, he is real. He has angels and demons that are out the whole world to destroy. Whenever you see wars going on, that's the devil's work. When you see child abuse, that's the devil's work. When you see murders and rapes and terrible things on this planet, that's the devil's work. The devil is the one disrupting and destroying people groups, ethnicities, racism. That's the devil's job. But he uses humans, just like God uses humans. The devil uses humans. Who's hurt you most in your life? Humans. Some of you, it's your cat. But if that's your cat, then you need to get some friends. But anyway, it's a joke. So this is the point of this message. I just want to tell you that some of our problems in life are to do with the demonic and to do with these wounds that we are carrying since for carrying without dealing and taking them to Jesus to heal. And what I want to say is that the good news is that Jesus can heal, and he's given us authority to do these things. You see, Jesus has all authority. He has all power and he has all authority. Authority is like being able to do something, and power is the means to do it. So a policeman carries his badge. He is a policeman. He has authority, but he needs a weapon to carry it out. That's his gun. And Jesus has given us all power and authority. We have the authority because we're Christians. We are born again, and we have the weapons. We pray. We have the Holy Spirit, we have the Word of God, and we can rebuke these things. We can tell these things to leave our lives if we come into line with what God is asking for us. And like I said, which hopefully in another time we'll get more explained, the key ways that things come and affect us is A, when we are sinning. Our own sin has consequences. Please understand that. I am not one of those religious, super heavy preachers or people, I really hope I'm not bringing that, but I also understand the importance of holiness and right living by the power of the Holy Spirit. Okay, God is good, God knows what's best for us. If he says something in the word is sin, it's sin. It doesn't matter if it's the 21st century, it doesn't matter if culture says it's okay. Don't listen to that rubbish. Read the Bible. If God says to you that gossip, jealousy, envy is sin, it's sin. If God says to you that sex outside marriage is sin, it's sin. If God says to you stealing is sin, it's sin. If God says to you lying is sin, it's sin. So one way is sin. If you're walking in these things constantly, you're giving access to the devil. be, what others do to you, if someone, if your family have hurt you, if words have been spoken over you that you're living with, if your parents are wicked to you, if you were cheated on by your husband or wife, these things can leave woundings, and the longer we don't treat them, the more the devil gets access. 3, generational stuff. Now, this is again hugely contested, but I'll summarize it quickly. We know that you look like your parents, you look like your grandparents, and there's similar traits. Like, we look at Esther, our daughter. Oh, she's got my pinky white Scottish skin. Oh, she's got a bit of red hair, look, my beard. But she's got her mother's eyes, a bit like this. I'm not being racist, she has a bit of her mother's eyes, which are like this. Okay, so, physically we accept that. And we also, what does a doctor ask you if you've got a heart problem? Is it in your family? So we accept it also from a medical point. So why don't we accept it spiritually? Now, I'm not saying that you're responsible for your father's or your ancestor's sin. You are not. But the consequences of those sin can fall on you. And the Bible says to the 3rd and 4th generation, up to the 10th generation for sexual sin. So, if, for example, your parents were in a false religion, Buddhism, or they were into the occult, you never did it. But there could be something still of darkness affecting you from that you can get free from. And that's very important to understand, that it's not that you're responsible for what people have done. Please understand, I'm not saying that you are responsible for your grandparent sleeping or committing adultery, but because you're in the generational line, you can receive, let's say, like a bit of dirt down sometimes. So you have to, in all these things, I don't want you, my heart isn't that you get paranoid or worried. My heart is that you go to God and ask. Sit down, look at your life, be honest, journal. See if there are sinful things that you just can't get free from. See if there are internal bondages that you just notice, like, yes, I have this same struggle that my mother had, or my auntie had, or my uncle. See if there's things in your life that you can't get free from. Depression. Are you living with 30 years of depression? Yes, sometimes we have depressive days, or maybe a week or two. That's like I said, we're in a fallen world. Sometimes we just get things. But if there's things that are more long-term, that are more inexplainable, you don't understand it, but you're just like that, start to ask God to reveal things. Ask Him to expose any darkness in you. It's very simple. And there are very simple keys to get out of it, which I hope myself or Vivian can explain another time. So again, I just... I hope I've explained it okay. This is my first time preaching on this, and I'm looking at my phone now, and I've filmed 30 odd minutes, and I don't think I've done a great job. But just go and ask God, please, if there are things in your life where the devil has a foothold from anything. And if you think the devil has a foothold, start to ask God why. Where did this doorway open? What is it that I need to close in my life? I'll leave with you now the key ways to get free. The key ways. Vivian will explain, Vivian will explain in another time, but I want to leave you with something, otherwise maybe you're going to panic. The key ways to remove the rights of the devil are this. Repentance. You say sorry. For example, when I came back to God, I said, God, I'm sorry for doing... Because that's where I gave an entrance to the devil. That's one key thing. You apologize to God. Repent. It's very simple. Don't get spiritual on me and say, oh, Heavenly Father. Just say to God this. God, I'm sorry that I slept with this woman outside of marriage. It was sin. I'm sorry. God is so forgiving. He wants you to be cleaned. He wants you to have lightness inside of you, peace. You say, I'm sorry for that. I repent. I'm sorry for that, God. And the other key is forgiveness. You have to forgive people that have hurt you. I understand it's painful. There are some people that have been through terrible things, but I'm telling you, unforgiveness is a prison that you are locking yourself in. You may have been hurt 30 years ago and you're like this, but you need to ask God. And it's not a feeling. Just say, God, be honest to Him. God, I choose to forgive my mom because She slapped me on my bottom when I was 5 and it still hurts. Something, you just choose to forgive the person. And as that pain is there, you let it out, you cry, you scream to God, you forgive that person. It's a choice, it's not a... Do you know when Jesus was on the cross, he said, Father, I forgive them. He wasn't like this, oh Father, I forgive them. No, he was like, he could barely talk. He was suffering, he had the sin on him, but he chose it. And the more you choose, God, I forgive that person, it's a deep thing. You'll feel releasing. And then when your emotions will lined up and with that forgiveness, and you'll feel more and more free. And then the final thing is just whatever the devil that's affecting your life, whatever's afflicting you, say go in Jesus' name. If you have anything that comes to mind, this go. You have authority. That's what I'm saying. When you remove the ground of the devil through repentance and forgiveness, it's like this. And then you just say, go in Jesus' name. This thing that's in me, you go. And these are just the starts. This is just the start of what it is to get rid of some of these things. There's more complex brokenness or issues that maybe we can talk about in the next time, because I would go over it more detail in the future. But oh, I really, really hope that you understood what I said, and that, you know, my heart and Vivian's heart is to see this church grow. And I think a lot of stuff doesn't happen, not just in TLC but other churches, because people are carrying all these things their whole life. They're carrying this backpack of whatever, heavy weight, because they won't just, and Jesus says, hey, get rid of it. You can get rid of it. And that's the great news. I want to leave you with that hope. You can get free from things. You don't have to always carry things. That's the gospel. I mean, we're always focusing on the gospel on the outside. Oh, I want to be rich. I want to be famous. No, I want to be healed on the inside. I want to be as whole as I can be on the inside. We're not going to be perfect this life. Don't get me wrong. We're not. Because that will only come when we die and are resurrected. But we can get healed. We can get stronger. We can get freer on the inside, so that when the outside things come in the world we face, we are more strong, solid, healed. And better disciples. The whole point of this is to become more like Jesus and to have his character. And these things are in the way of us becoming more like Jesus, because gossiping isn't like Jesus, and lying isn't like Jesus, and being bound to addictions of drugs and alcohol isn't like Jesus, and sleeping around with men and women and being addicted to pornography, this isn't like Jesus. We need to get free. But there's no condemnation. Please remember, he is for you, he is for us, and He is faithful. So let me close in prayer. Father God, I thank you for this. I thank you that you, dear Jesus, you came, you died, you were buried, you were resurrected, and you ascended for us. But thank you that you also set an example for us. God, thank you that you, Jesus, and your Holy Spirit are here to bind up the brokenhearted, not only to heal the physical sick, but to heal our inside pain. And God, I ask by your Holy Spirit that you would speak to the church. Lord, I've tried my best to present what I'm to present, and I just ask, Holy Spirit, that you would take what I've shared and touch their hearts, Lord, for these people. May they not just reject it. May they not reject it out of fear or unbelief. May they not reject it out of, this isn't my theology. May they not reject it out of just confusion. But Lord, may you just start to work at them. Show them things in their life, Lord. Just show them things where they can really get those stones removed, finally, those stones that they carry. They've carried for years, Father. Bring them that lightness. Thank you, Jesus. Your yoke is light. Your yoke is light. So I bless this church in Jesus' name. I thank you for it, Lord. Continue your work in each one of our lives, and we just commit the rest of the week into your hands. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much, and God bless you.
Thank you, Matthew, for the message that you have shared for today. May God bless you and protect you and continue to strengthen you spiritually with the ministry that he entrusted in you. Before we close, I would like to make some few announcements concerning next week, starting with the Friday prayer meeting from 8 p.m. to 10 p.m. It will be here at church. I repeat, it will be here at church, all right? The place is limited only for 15 people, and for that, we will post an announcement on our Facebook group, TLC, so you can reserve
your place if you want to come. Please comment. The first 15 people who will comment on that post will be reserved for Friday prayer meeting. All right? We will post the announcement about Friday prayer meeting tonight at 6 p.m. On Sunday, we have our Sunday school from 9:30 a.m. to 10:30 a.m. led by Brother David. After that, we have our online service from 10:30. And don't forget to prepare your communion. And yes, our service is still online next week. I hope that's clear. And if you have any questions, you can always ask us, one of the leaders, and we will answer you as fast as possible. To end, I'd like to greet our birthday celebrants this week. It will be my older brother, my big brother Joshua De Guzman on 31st of May, so it's tomorrow. And also the same date is Tita Sister Laureline Tud. We greet you a happy birthday, and may God bless you. So thank you for tuning in, and I hope that you guys have a great week. God bless. Bye.
So tight when I try to say